next, dog. That ain't even what I'm on. I'm sipping with my hitters, chilling in my zone. Think twice before you start some fun.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We've got one more series for you here today on this stream. It's going to be Na'Vi versus Gambit coming up. I'm at ODPixel, of course, here with Fogged. We do have some updates to keep you updated with. The other series going on at the moment on the other two streams, they're still halfway through there, so I believe we'll be able to get the results on your screen right now, at least the current standings of those situations. So just now, we had TNC versus Aster 2-0, of course, here on the main stream. Mm-hmm. But currently going on the B stream at ONE Esports SGG underscore A, you have Secret versus Alliance, where Secret did just take game one, but a bit of a spoiler and a heads up. Game two is looking a bit better for Alliance.
Looks right? A little better for Alliance at the moment.
So yeah. Certainly an interesting one to keep your eyes on. And also, obviously, on stream C, JStorm versus VP is halfway through the action. The action here, though, as I say, Na'Vi versus Gambit. The draft has begun, so we'll be able to get that up on your screens very, very shortly. And this should be a pretty hyped CIS showdown, Vogt.
For sure. I mean, these teams have... sound interesting in my ears right now. These teams have played each other quite a lot. That's for sure. So this should be a pretty interesting one, at least in that. And I think a lot of hero picks. These guys are going to be very comfortable with each other and just the style that they're playing. Gambit's looking hot, though. GPK, Dream, these guys are absolute beasts. I think they've been winning majority of their matchups, especially GPK. He's been really styling for their team. Na'Vi, though, on their side, too, they've got a lot of interesting stuff up their sleeves. I mean, Magical has been on point with pretty much all the heroes that he's very comfortable. And Zayats, like, he's definitely an X factor in a lot of these games. His Doom, you always have to watch out for a lot of these like weirder heroes that he does play in that four position.
Yeah, I believe we just had Na'Vi come out of a series against LGD. Of course, taking them down 2-0, and Magical in particular having some standout performances in the mid lane against the big boy Somnus from LGD. So, yeah, just to iterate now how much you cannot underrate Magical's mid lane performance. And how well this Na'Vi side is looking to gel together,
yep.
With some of the new talent and, of course, those big old-school CIS names, such as the man Pasha himself, of course, being on Na'Vi now on the off lane. So here we have it. The draft has begun. We're already into the bans. Bans so far, Doom and TA are going to be the ones taken out by Gambit and Na'Vi. They've knocked out the Lone Druid, Beastmaster, and, of course, there it is, the tree, which we are expecting to continue to see and have pretty much seen in every single draft.
Yep.
Mainly banned.
Has he been, no. Has he been,
has
picked?
Ever, has I don't it
think
ever
it,
not been
banned
I think,
every game.
I think you're right. I think it's pretty much just not got through. Maybe there's an outlier of a game or two. Obviously, there's a lot of games going on. A lot of things to keep up with. And the Venge, the other sort of... So same popularity, but seems to get through a lot more in the picks. You know, not necessarily going to be first phase bad every time, but
it's lost games. It's losers games. It's not
sure.
Like these crazy heroes that we've seen. And as you mentioned, you know, Gambit specifically banning out Magical. You know, you ban that TA, you ban that Shadow Fiend too, and then yeah, you ban that Doom, which we've seen played quite a lot, having a super successful win rate so far at this tournament. Yeah, I think Venge is a neat one for Na'Vi because I think it opens up a lot. I think this is one of the heroes that we were about to mention that pairs very well with that Venge. And
Viper, Terrorblade. Viper, understandable, but the Terrorblade coming in very early.
We saw them doing this, though. Remember during the qualifiers that we watched when we were at your place? They would pick the TB so they can get that aura, right? They're going to now be throwing the reflection onto the Venge, so their TB is able to benefit from it a lot. And you're going to be playing versus a lot of these auras,
smart.
So
that's
it's
smart.
Pretty cool. We did see them do this the other day. So.
If you don't get it, get yourself a hero that's going to be able to steal it for yourself. I like the thinking there from Gambit.
Yep.
And obviously Viper. Well, we've seen a few teams, right, have very much been on board the first pick, Viper,
it's crazy,
Gambit,
bro.
And obviously Alliance have been also doing this a lot, having this very, very strong Viper player. And as you say, you know, I imagine it is obviously going to be GPK playing it in the mid. He's going to be devastated with the series. You said already, this
he's
guy,
owning
he's talented.
All his wins, all his matchups,
the
he's
great
winning.
Thing about Viper is it's pretty easy to play that match. You know, for most of the heroes that you're going to be against, so already if you put this incredibly talented mid laner on a Viper, they're terrifying. You've got to be prepared for this if you're Na'Vi. You know, you got Magical's got to really seriously think what he's going to be happy going to lane against this house.
Yeah, I'm what can he play too versus Viper? We've seen the Viper pretty much dominate everything now, I think. I don't know. It's very limited to see what you can actually put up against him.
Your best bet is it's going to be a hero that's going to have some sort of recovery mechanic. You know, a hero that's going to say, you know what, it doesn't matter if I'm going to get sort of out-leveled in the lane. I'm going to be able to head to the jungle, clean up some stacks. Suddenly, we're back on an even footing.
if they don't ban all of them, right? They already took out the TA and that Shadow Fiend early on, even though those matchups are pretty hard for them versus a Viper, of course.
But that's the thing.
They're the backups to go to the jungle.
Exactly. You know, and that really does show, you know, because Gambit are banning those. Because I think previously people would be like, they're like, well, why are they banning TA? Why are they banning us? These are heroes that the Viper can beat in lane. Well, yeah, sure he can, but they're going to catch up and they're going to be able to get back on the pace that the Viper's going to get ahead at. So very excited to see this and see what Na'Vi's idea is going to be to address it.
I like how they already, I know, like we said, these teams know each other so well. You see, they ban out the Earth Spirit. They're like, this is a Pasha Venge. We know this. We've seen this. Na'Vi's been one of the teams that have been playing that offlane Venge probably more than anybody that I've seen, just because we saw them all those during those like group those qualifiers that we did see, at least from earlier on. So yeah, they know they have to target out different heroes. I like the Earth Spirit ban is definitely nice. I think Terra Blade can be a little annoyed just from like the silence pull, and it's Na'Vi. They love that hero. And then the Phoenix as well. I think they've loved this hero throughout all iterations of Na'Vi, right? I look at Phoenix and I'm like, oh, Sineko's on the team again? Oh, no, wait. They just still really like the comp, like, just like the hero overall, especially versus TB. That high magic damage is very nice.
Yeah, sort of talking about the combo. I mean, what's in at the moment that really would benefit quite nicely? I mean, is there still room for Na'Vi to like slide in a puck?
I think so.
To have that control to hold heroes down underneath a supernova.
That's the one I was thinking. I think Gambit takes it.
They're stealing it.
That was literally the first one that I was thinking about too. Just because the Venge puck is so good, it fits really well with Phoenix. Puck is high magic damage versus Terra Blade. Yeah. It definitely fit Na'vi's draft well. But
they wanted it. They're not going to get it. They're not going to get it. Gambit's got it.
And it's a great hero versus Phoenix. Phoenix does not like to play versus silences too much. Makes your game a lot more difficult for you to get off your spells. Get off that supernova, of course, in position.
And of course, the combo. Aghanim's Terrorblade, not gonna happen. Get the fear with the dream coil.
Wait, does it even do that anymore? Did they change the Aghanim's Terrorblade?
I don't think I ever saw a single person ever do it.
I definitely didn't see anybody build it.
If it's still there, it probably doesn't matter because no one's ever gonna buy Aghanim's on Terrorblade. Disruptor. So that's gonna be their extra bit of form of control. Team fight starting to add up from Na'Vi.
Yep. That's that AoE silence. It makes like Terrorblade cannot. You don't want to fight for quite a long time there, especially because of that. It makes your game a lot more difficult. Good ways to protect the egg, but right now they're squishy. Venge is a little bit. Venge is an exception. Venge can be a bit tanky, but their supports are not the tankies at the moment. 5 seconds
remaining. We'll see Gambit now. Obviously, with these heroes picked up, still. So with these sort of teams with the puck, are you assuming this is as like a 3 or a 4?
I think I could even throw this as a 5, honestly. I could even just give this FNG.
Any of those roles.
Yeah. I mean, it's maybe now it's because it's been nerfed a little bit. It's been reduced, of course, on like the level 1 waning rift and all that. But we were seeing it 5 quite a bit right when it was first changed. So
yeah,
we were seeing Puppy playing it. We were seeing everybody.
Them.
Kuroki was playing it. All the players were trying it out. So I think it's very flexible. Keep yourself open for sure which role you do want to prioritize it in, how much levels, items you think you actually need.
Let's see Gambit. Still themselves. I mean, wonder if they do want to go for some sort of way to force sort of dream coil snaps.
Okay.
Tusk is in, so a bit of save.
Strong, very strong with Terror Blade. You just get that tag team going. He's that metamorph. He's always going to be able to do that. You can actually protect people too pretty nicely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, no, yeah. A nicely timed snowball. You know, it's just sort of that fallback, right? It's like, well, we're not going to be able to kill the egg. Everybody getting the snowball. We're going to at least still have some sort of counterplay. Magnus slips through nice and late into the draft. Na'Vi able to get their hands on it as their fourth pick. And of course, well, will be Magical's hero. And that is going to be that sort of hero that. You are going
to
have a tough time against the Viper. Like, the Viper should have the edge in that matchup, but to a point, it doesn't matter because you are going to have that catch-up mechanic. You're just going to go jungle.
I feel like that made Tusk a little bit better, though, to my thing.
What, an extra bit? Yeah?
Yeah, because he's good. He's pretty good versus Magnus. You have a great save that you can provide. You can mess with him, too. He tries to go for, like, a combo. You get punched up in the air. There's a couple of things that Tusk can definitely do to throw that one off for sure. But I think Magnus is just because he's going to get that big farm.
Yeah, and I think because there is that first pick Viper and you're getting like the TAs, the SFs, Magical, Stronger Heroes, Bandai, his options were limited. And I think this is the best that was sort of left out of the selections for him in the mid lane. And it's Na'Vi. Final ban, Gambit. They'll obviously ban out a standard safe laner that's going to be able to utilize the Empower.
What can Gambit pick here?
Void's going to be the one to go.
I want Gambit to get a dom, like a dom carrier, or like someone that can build a drum as well, or something like that. Like that's the one I don't really like drum so much. But versus Phoenix,
I mean, I'll be honest, dude.
These type of things are pretty good.
Oh, wait, no, okay, Doom was banned first. So I was going to be like, hang on, is Doom still...
No, Doom is gone. Doom is gone. No way, man. Whoa, not in this game. You're playing versus Na'Vi. I think you have to ban. If Na'Vi has first pick, you're going to ban the Doom.
But yeah, any other sort of similar playmaking heroes like that on the offlane? Na'Vi's turn. Yeah, Bat's going to be the ban. Na'Vi, they're going to go themselves with that Bloodseeker.
Okay. He gets buffed up quite a lot here from both that Venge and the Magnus. The silence is always going to be really nice, of course, too, versus like the TB. They've got a lot of ways, a lot of team fight coming out from Na'Vi.
And a lot of AoE, yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. It's so much follow-up. It's going to be huge chain reaction, you know, any sort of supernova stun into static storms, RPs, blood rites. There's so much follow-up that, if Na'Vi start to get ahead in team fight, they can very easily snowball it in their favor, despite not being the team with the snowball.
What if they snowball dodge the Disruptor ult, the Magnus ult, and the Blood Rite?
But that's the thing, you're not going to be able to dodge everything.
Yeah, it's definitely...
That really is the...
Makes it harder.
So, you know, yeah, it makes the Tusk game very difficult. Yep. You know, this Tusk has to be very, very, very smart about when he decides to go in with these saves. Because there's going to be something outside of the snowball. You're going to take him out of some sort of horror and ride them straight into the next nightmare.
Yeah, oh God, I just pulled us into a static storm. Yeah. Definitely a possibility to happen. So
Gambit looking for, as we'd imagine, that offlane. You certainly expect to see Puck and Tusk as the support combo.
Yeah, you wonder what Shashla's looking at. We saw a good amount of Brewmaster being picked up here in this tournament already. Which, I mean, he looked pretty decent.
I mean, I wonder if there's anything else that you kind of want to help hit the egg, but I guess that doesn't matter too much. You do have Viper, and if TB's got the Metamorphosis,
they should be able to kill it.
Reach the egg pretty safely.
Even Puck is okay. I mean, it's not good to hit the egg in any means, but you have at least like a range.
I mean, can they put the Puck on the offlane and like slip a silencer in against all this team fight?
I was thinking they could still move the Puck in the offlane. I think it looks pretty solid in this game because you have like this strong Dispel versus the Magnus can always be annoying, and you're able to get into the back lines and deal with these annoying supports that need to be all about positioning, right? Like Disruptor Phoenix, you're all about getting your positioning based, and I think Brewmaster messes a lot with when you are playing these positioning heroes. And he builds Dominator, and it's really good with Terror Blade, so why not?
Yeah. No, you're right. Yeah, if Brew sort of gets these utility items, Gambit are going to have this very devastating push, and Oh, look at this. It is the FNG Viper.
So it's the five-position Viper.
The five Viper.
And the Puck mid.
I got heavily reported for playing five Viper. FNG's going to show why it's so good.
Well, yeah, you played it in Europe. Only NA plays the five Viper.
Yeah, and I did try and build FaZe Dragon Lance Maelstrom for the five position, which is probably not what FNG's going to do.
No, definitely not. And they also you mentioned it's FNG playing the Viper. Yep. It's Pasha playing the Phoenix. We were mentioning how Pasha was probably playing the Venge.
And you're immensely sort of old school Na'Vi. I mean, just old school Pasha, right? You know, he was sort of one of the man's back in the days, I don't know how long, about 20 years ago, playing on VP and doing offlane Phoenix. That's his style.
And they liked it a lot, if I'm not recalling completely poorly, is they liked it a lot versus Terrorblade. And they like prioritizing the levels on it. And that's why they are moving it to the call role. Because I think we saw LGD also. FY and them, they used to do it sometimes. They'd be like, ooh, we're versus TB. Let's put Chalice on this Phoenix. Let's switch it up a little bit.
At that point then, do you need to dodge that lane as Dream? Like, because that Phoenix, you said, if you're in the offlane role, in that lane against him, once he's sort of level 3, that's a lot of pressure on Dream. And you don't have any sort of, you haven't got like a Warlock or Witch Doctor. You don't have anyone that's going to be able to offer any sort of sustain in the lane. So if this Terrorblade is consistently pressured by a Phoenix, he's going to have to be throwing out a lot of regen to be able to stand in the lane against him.
Oof, that's a lot of Terrorblade games. He has like over 500 Terrorblade games, and his last one, he was godlike, it looks like.
Oh, let's see. Oh, I'm sure he's played against a few Phoenixes in his time.
Yeah, I'm wondering if they're going to set up like maybe, I don't know, like they have to scout lanes is number one, but I wonder how they're going to actually move the Viper and where they're going to put the Tusk. Do they put the Tusk in the safe lane with the Terrorblade, or do they tri-lane after they get a first blood? Curious to see how they do set up to secure Dream's farm. Because they have to expect that he's going to be playing versus quite a hard pressure lane coming out from that Phoenix plus one. That's a lot of tips. Are you okay? Did everyone just tip? How many tips was that? Like 9 tips?
Well, then everybody got involved.
Everyone got tipped. Look, nobody got like harassed either. It was a very friendly tip. Zayats was the only one who got more than one.
He won out, right? Zayats got a couple.
Look at that. And also, I'm just curious what this Viper can do. I have not actually gotten to see the Viper 5 position, only in like a couple pub games, but not a pro game.
The poison attack, it's nasty.
Yeah.
It is nasty. The sweet spot really is when you hit level 3, though. Just the fact that the damage doubles. You know, from level 1 to level 2, that increases. You feel it. I mean, they feel it. It hurts.
Yeah, you start getting those stacks built up for sure. Mm. It can be quite potent. I mean, Tuscan Viper support sounds kind of clowny, but it sounds pretty good, actually, because you have this ranged hero that's always going to be benefiting from the tag team.
Absolutely.
It's kind of neat. So let's see how this one plays out here with the start. So we do see that aggro tri-lane. Do we have any bizarre items? I just see a lot of regen being built up when I was clicking on heroes. Just tons of tangos, tons of salves, and a couple extra fairy fires and mangoes. I saw the Viper had, I think, 3 mangoes was the only biggest surprise, but this hero does burn through a hell of a lot of mana, especially if you're playing, I guess, in the support role.
Yeah, I'll be interested to see how quickly FNG does burn through those mangoes, because that is a lot. You know,
3 is a lot.
That is a lot.
That's his whole mana pool
like, sure,
fully refreshed.
Sure, you do burn through it, but it still takes a fair bit of time. And yeah, but I'll be interested to see how much FNG gets through the mana pool, at least when he's on the level 1, because the level 1 itself, I mean, it certainly can be annoying enough to harass them away. And in this lane, the pressure will be there on the Bloodseeker.
I mean, that's like over 45 or 48 poison attacks or something like that, right? Something like, with the mana that he's got with all 3 mangoes, it's a lot of poison attacks.
I mean, yeah, maybe Shashlo's going to be getting some of the mango loving from FNG.
That's true. That is true.
I can share the good old fruit down there. But yeah, this that top lane as well. Both carries certainly going to be feeling the heat in these lanes. Dream against this sort of constant Thunderstrike spam and this core Phoenix. A huge amount of magical damage available from this hero early on in the laning stage. Stream will put the first meta and look to secure the first wave or so against Na'Vi's pressure.
They find an Obs in Zayats. He's actually getting cardio by a tag team. The hits are building up. The Fire Spirits also are building up onto Dream, though.
Yeah, Dream has to be so careful how he steps forward. Pasha just able to instantly put a stop to any sort of aggressive play from the Terrorblade.
I'm glancing at mid because I know how aggressive these guys play.
Well, they got you're gonna see
both of them are gonna
low,
try to. Yeah, I'm gonna
to
keep looking.
Each other.
Yeah. Both have their salves now, so all right, we can look elsewhere for a moment.
Yeah, it's gonna be fun to see. It's gonna be fun to see. Yeah, some GPK puck.
Yeah, that should be pretty cool. I'm curious to see what type of build he's gonna go for. If you guys go for what we've been seeing popularized, you know, the javelin. A lot of the times people are doing, so you can get that phase shift bonus damage. As
here we go. It starts getting nice now. The level 2, and you know, it's sure you can trade with him.
FNG has to back away.
But you know, FNG's fine with this. You know, which level 2 you've got the passive, what do you do against the support Viper? You don't want to hit him.
No.
You don't want to punch back because you just end up taking way more damage than you're able to deal to him.
And I know that Brian was talking about in the last game is how the Cinderbrew was changed in 7.23, so any magical damage procs it. So the actual poison attack from Viper.
Yep.
Procs that Cinderbrew, which is pretty crazy that it just allows it to do that ignite damage. Plus, it gets buffed up because it's a magic amplifier, that poison attack. So, they're making the move bottom. Ilias, see that already building in. Look how slow he is. Doing so much damage.
This is the problem when you try and get aggressive when there's a Viper in the lane. He'll just turn and you're never going to win the trade on these early levels. The Viper's always going to come out on top.
Dude, you actually take so much. You get slowed so much, and you take so much damage from the Cinderbrew with just the poison attacks.
You wait until you see that level 2 poison attack come out. That's when it gets really nasty.
Maybe they even put. We saw the 1-4-1 build from the Cinder Brewmaster from by 33 before. Could be a possibility again here with this Viper. You just keep procking it off every time.
There we go. I'm gonna try and get aggressive again. Mangoes are gonna be popped. Bringing FNG a little low, but as soon as the silence ends, now he's going to start to turn. And now this is where it's crystallized. You're like, am I really going to be able to do this? He will. He will get in this time. Big kill there for Crystallize, as he is able to put a stop to the Viper's reign for now down on this bottom lane.
Okay, he's going to clap.
Whoa. Magic missile from Ilias says, whoa, Crystallize, take a step back, sir. Oof. This Brewmaster wants your blood.
Definitely could have been scary if he gets the Drunken Brawler off and gets a hit off on him.
Oh, here it comes. Here comes the dragon. Or whatever it is.
How's mid looking? Both constantly trying to pressure each other quite a bit. The last hits are fairly even. GPK a little bit ahead. He's got the bottle now picked up. You have to prioritize getting the room.
It's a race! A magical
will be okay. He has to get that rune, otherwise it's big problems for him. Because he saw that GPK has the bottle. He does not have one. That's a full reset for that puck. Mid? Still pressured? It's a little scary there.
How's Crystallize doing on the regen? He's got a south top lane. Last time round, the two of them will be able to take down Zayat. Splash are not able to do enough to keep his support safe.
I love Tusk with Terrorblade. It really is such a good combo. Hey, look at this. This five position Viper. Oh my god.
I mean, this is now the level 2 poison attack. That damage doubles.
Yeah. Crystallize is very speedy as several heroes are low on the map, but he can't actually step up. They have no regen, like you were mentioning, in that bottom lane. Meanwhile, Gambit do. His dream will be able to get himself out of there up top. And these bounties are going to be exchanged, which looks like Gambit's going to get a benefit. They got 3 for 1.
Oh yeah, you're right. They did manage to pick up the third. Good news there for Gambit. You can see it, 5 minutes in, 2k lead for Gambit. Going out on top of the lanes.
See if anyone does look to make a rotation. I see GPK has hit level 6 now in the mid lane.
Oh, can they get this? Ilias is trying to turn, but Avengy brings him down with him. That's the Viper way. It doesn't matter if you die, as long as you bring down someone with you. Especially if you get them first. Solo XP for FNG. He's smiling all the way back to the base.
Is he going to go anywhere else? Maybe to the mid lane to fill the bottle and make a move? Definitely a possibility.
Top lane, Pasher able to get some nice deep fire spirits planted onto the face of XS Vampire.
Mm-hmm. And he's just going to... he actually is still going to go bottom. I thought maybe he was going to help the puck to fill out the bottle for a GPK, but Rune is coming out. Looks like GPK will set up for that one as Magical is kind of just stacking up jungle for himself here, as we do see Magnus do quite a lot. And checking bottom Rune. He's praying to Gaben. It won't work.
Easy regen rune there for GPK, and well needed one as well, but for all the mana.
Ooh,
he's going to look towards top, maybe see if he can turn around this play. Zayat's poking around with excess vampire, but now there's the trap with the shards. Zayat is stuck. They pop down a field, but there's no escape. As GPK is able to quickly jump in, get the pickoff. Down bottom, aggression onto Crystallize. Ilias keeps Crystallize safe. And again, this constant pressure onto the Bloodseeker, making this lane very hard for him to play. Top lane, Pasha actually able to get in on his own and take down Excess Vampire straight underneath the nose of Dream.
Yeah, and he's up to level 5. This is, I think the Phoenix getting levels is super important here for Na'Vi. Like we said, they like this hero versus Terrorblade. We've seen a lot of teams definitely do that versus the TB. So he's getting a good support. You said Crystallize is getting shut down a hell of a lot right now. It's problematic. Sashlo is way more farmed than he is. Having an excellent time, level 5, almost 6.
Oh, he might be dead here. If FNG wants to dive the tower, this could be a kill.
He's got the 5 stacks on him. He's still ticking
low. It's going to be a lot. It really is a lot.
Oh, my goodness. Actually got him pretty low. The coil actually coming out in mid. It's a max level silence on GPK.
He may have the burst damage. Not quite.
Not quite.
Yeah, just that one level in orb, so doesn't want to throw it in, doesn't want to overextend, but still. Pushing the magical Magnus back.
Yeah, the double bracer build coming into play for sure, just being that extra tanky, as we have seen a lot on those Magnus. But yeah, I like that GPK went for the maxing the silence in this game first over Mag. I've still seen a lot of players like are maxing the orb in a lot of situations, but in this game you can see how good it is versus Phoenix, versus pretty much like everybody on their lineup. It's just absolutely excellent, and he's actually walking forward and taking some stacks.
Yeah, he's going to be able to see if we get the large creeps as well, but at least take some of that stack away from Magical's half of the map.
Oh, Dream got a dream for himself. He got the jelly on that Terrorblade. I think that's one of the better items he could have gotten here on this Terrorblade over here. He's just going to be able to constantly spam out his Conjure Image now and farm a lot faster in the jungle because of that. I say a lot faster. 1.3 mana region, but you know, it's a lot for your carries.
He's happy. No, he's certainly happy with that find. Definitely one of the more favorable ones to grab. Ocean's Heart. That's a nice little bit of stats. No one really in a position where they're going to be playing in the river that much, though. Bottom lane, Ilias steps forward a little too far.
This combo is insane.
It's strong.
This Brewmaster Viper on the same lane, this magic resistance reduction, and Brewmaster doing so much damage, he's already got Dominator finished. It's 8 minutes in.
Man, you can sort of see as well, Na'Vi, I don't think they want to send anyone down to that bottom lane now.
No, definitely not.
That lane's sort of a no-go zone. Gambit are taking control of that. And obviously, it all very, very important for the dire side to get that early control on the outpost.
Whoop. GPK. They will be able to get it. The snowball commit forward is a bit over-aggressive here by Vampire.
Should pay
the coil's broken.
Oh, Apache steps forward. He's going to pop the egg. They're going to try and kill it. And a level 1 egg, that'll be no trouble for them at all. GPK is able to jump out as well with the orb. He's got the bottle charges, so Ilias won't be able to beat him down. GPK can walk out of that one.
kind of, but we mentioned, we hyped up GPK quite a lot before this game, and he's definitely delivering already.
It's
here. 3-0.
Looking good. All three of Gambit's cores at the top three of the net worth for just 9 minutes in. 3K lead.
Yeah. And he's got the jelly as well, also given to him, of course, on that puck, so we'll make his movements a lot easier to have that extra bit of mana regen. And I did see Dream got a shovel for himself. So another, like, just solid items, these neutral items for Gambit. 3K gold lead already for themselves. And this, I mean, this Brewmaster, you don't want to go anywhere near him, like you mentioned. Anyone who comes down is probably going to die to him as Zayas. The Shockwave blocks the Cinder Brew.
He doesn't have a TP. It's on cooldown for 40 seconds. This should be a kill for Gambit.
He's trying to hide. Oh.
They've found him.
Hello.
FNG is going to come in to join in with the fun. As we said, you do not want to come down here if you're Na'Vi.
No, and this coil caught on too, but Magical is here.
See if they can turn this. They're not going to lose Ilias. Says Vampire a bit deep, tries to push him back with the shards, but crystallizes here to help finish off the killing trade. One for one with the supports falling. Shashlo in with the rotation, tries to get on top of Pasha, won't quite be able to make it. Turn his attention over towards the Magnus. Anybody get the Primal split off though with the Bloodbright Silence in place?
They're forcing them away from the outpost though. They got the bottom one already as well. They're really trying to make sure that they deny Na'Vi this either one of these outposts.
Yeah, they're
going to get it. Pasha?
Tries for a dive in play. If FNG can get a few poison attacks off, he's going to get the one. Orbs in, won't quite reach Pasha. Pasha will be able to back off. But Gambit continuing to maintain very good control of this early game.
And in the meanwhile, they force everybody top. Dream's like, okay, I can just walk to the mid lane. I can actually make use of my meta with an Arcane Rune. So double the benefit here coming out for him as Gambit's making all the right moves. Na'Vi is starting to fall quite a bit behind here already in this early game.
It's already looking like it's going to be a very hard game for Crystallize to get involved.
Yeah.
As being held that far behind at the start as a Bloodseeker, this very, very potent lane from Gambit, the Viper comboing with the Brewmaster has shut down his early game. Mid lane, Dream, it's going to be set up on. And we'll land the stun into the silence. Supernova pop, Dream's trying to walk away. They're dragging back. He just get the Sunder, tries for the TP, knows he cannot do so because the Supernova stun will hit him. He's still able to walk out. Dream's still alive, but finally falls. Pasha will be able to burn him down, finish up the job back in the river.
Oh.
Magical, he's got the RPO too. The Bloodbright follow-up, it's going to be dodged. The snowball's there just in time. FNG and XS Vampire turn with the power of Shashlo. The swap out will be there in attempt to save Magical, but Shashlo's on top of him with the Primal Split as Magical goes down 2-for-2. Between Gambit, maybe FNG goes down as well. The illusion beating down upon him will pop the stick charges, but Crystallize will finish him off. As Na'Vi, they'll come out on top of this trade for now. Crystallize still having a bit of a poke around. Exodus Vampire and Shashlo are still quite scary. As Crystallize just resume farming, but a bit of a punch back there from Na'Vi.
Definitely, the GPK got caught out there in the mid lane trying to help out his buddy, trying to help out Dream. They do get brought down. He gets a great Sunder off, but yeah, that Phoenix Egg just putting out way too much damage in the midst of all of it, right in the middle of everybody. And yeah, it gives Crystallize a little bit more space, but immediately, Gambit, they just group up again. They look to go for the fight. So what happened to GPK? Because he got the Blink Dagger, I saw him TPing in, and then he blinked, he jumped into the Static Storm and got stun followed.
I mean, that was a misplay.
Yeah, right, that was a bit of a misplay. I was wondering what caught him, because I was looking up top here toward the RP.
Yeah, GPK knows he messed up.
Yeah. A bit of a mistake there, but still, they're playing confident. They're looking to take over Na'Vi's jungle. But Na'Vi, definitely, we do see them punching back there. Like we mentioned, they do have very strong team fight if they can get it into working together.
They do, and we really started to see a glimpse of that there in that last fight.
Glimpse, disrupt.
Uh-huh.
Just going to throw the ults, try to slow down the push a bit here, but inevitably it does look like this tower is going to go down for Na'Vi's Gambit's all surrounded on it. Meta is available for them too.
As we said, it does always feel very bad as the Radiant side losing this tier 1.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it very hard to reach that bottom outpost in comparison to how easy it will be for Gambit, with Gambit, of course, having their tier 1 still standing strong down there.
Yeah, and they're actually smoking up in the enemy jungle, looking to make an aggressive play up toward top, it looks like, try to catch something out. FNG does also have ward, so he probably wants to try to get one down here deep. He puts it down, but it's actually directly under a sentry ward right now in that enemy jungle. Still smoked up. Yeah, they really want to control this jungle. They're spotting Zayats. Zayats will now soon see that ward that was placed. Doesn't walk up the hill, though.
Yeah, I mean, Na'Vi, with the sort of pressure on, they are doing the best of it. In turn, they're mm-hmm. looking to take over what Gambit have on the top half of the map. Getting him deep into their jungle.
Doesn't feel as good, though. You know, no. Getting into the dire side
of
the map.
Because of the outpost and the shrine situation.
Yep.
Yeah.
Doesn't feel
like, sure,
nearly as good.
You're in their jungle, but they can reach with a shrine TP. That's not going to be the case in your own.
Yep, and they've also got access to your ancients. So that Terrorblade, you have to be a little worried that he's farming two sets of ancients quite often when you do lose control of your own jungle on that Radiant side now.
No, it does.
Secondary smoke. This is a back-to-back smoke by Gambit here. They're really looking to get something. It is coming up to that 15-minute mark. Those bounty runes. And they do a brew split, so definitely looking to try to take these fights.
Let's see what they can get a hold of here around the outpost. 15 minutes in, Magical. We'll be able to grab the bounty rune. Gambit hunting for a fight. Magical pretty tanky, of course, as this Magnus. Quick skewer back. Gets him away from the movement of Gambit, as Gambit will not be able to start a fight.
They respected Na'Vi's positioning there. With that smoke breaking, they're like, ooh, don't know if we want to go on this 2,300 HP Magnus. Definitely put you in a weird spot versus a Phoenix. Like you said, lots of team fight is the big thing you have to watch out for on Gambit versus that Na'Vi. Oop, bottom. Dream. Trying to look for the disruptor here. Besides, we'll be able to back away. Get a little bit of a surround on him going there, but no Metamorph.
Yeah, knows he can't spend too much time hunting around for the support kill as well. Very likely that backup is inbound from Na'Vi.
Dude, that Terrorblade's fear duration is a lot. We do actually see it with the coil. Like, it's 3.75
but
seconds.
You gotta get an Aghanim's,
you have to get
dude.
An Aghanim's.
Aghanim's.
I know, it's definitely won't happen, but.
That's a lot of money for a TB. I mean, it's one of those things that, hey, come to sort ooh. Of the later portions and say an Aghanim's drops from Rosh, maybe you're giving him some sort of priority, but
yep.
Not really many games that we've seen going to sort of the third Rosh point ooh. So far here.
Dream, he's trying to bring out his Manta, the courier, it flies right over them. That's the ulti orb, it's being pinged out,
yeah,
crystallized. He knows.
I mean, obviously, a lot of the time when you go for a smoke, you do want to avoid the courier because you want to look for a big kill. But maybe if they'd seen that quicker and seen it was his ulti orb, I think you'd say, screw the smoke, gang, we need to get rid of that Manta.
Now they know where he is, though, because they saw where the courier went with the ulti orb. They
but
had to go
are they
going to
be able to do anything with that information? Because Dream has backup.
And they're all
and Gambit's
there,
on the high ground. They're going to be able to jump in, they're already going to start things straight onto the disruptor, make sure there's no static storm threat. Zayats is gone. Na'Vi still trying to go for a bit of a fight here as Magical skewers forward. They are going to, he's going to hold on to the RP for now. Unable to quite trap GPK. GPK
he's
dancing around. There'll be a buyback from Zayats. They know that they need this static storm. They need the combo,
oh
Na'Vi.
God,
but
the
you'll
damage.
See there, Magical does not get off a single
ooh,
spell.
Swap.
The silence, the splurb writes down. They do burst out Dream in response. But it's two dead on Na'Vi. Static storm out. The Terrorblade is dead. But still, another fight where Na'Vi are struggling to come out on top. Gambit still holds the lead.
Gambit was really good the way that those rotations were crazy, right? They smoked into the enemy jungle, then they re-smoked into their jungle, and then they immediately ran toward bottom to go back to Dream when he was getting his item timing to try to protect him. Like you said, they do end up losing him, but they do get themselves quite beneficial kills on the enemy side of the map as well. So Na'Vi not going to be able to get anything else after that, after losing these heroes. And it was a great swap, honestly, from Ilias. If they didn't get that swap into the static storm there, I don't think Dream actually goes down.
No, they wouldn't have got anything at all if they didn't find that catch. Dream back in the game, immediately teeping down towards the bottom half of the map again. We'll see if Gambit want to get straight back on with another bit of an aggressive play. Of course, 80 seconds until Meta's back up, so maybe a bit of downtime.
I feel like this is where you'll see Dire play in almost every game. They're just going to take over bottom side. The whole right side of the map, the whole bottom side as well, and just their jungle. Sure, they'll put some wards in there to watch your movements, but I don't think they'll play around that so much.
No, I wonder if we will see, obviously, in the next 2 minutes, an attempt from Gambit to reclaim that top outpost.
Yeah, that might be the only time that they do look to reclaim their area.
It is going to be the same time when Meta's back up, so if they can somehow start to move over there, they would have a chance. So obviously we've only sort of a minute left to get in that position. They do start to send a few of them, not bringing Dream up here for now.
I see FNG drawing the line of him looking like he wants to try to control the whole map. He's drawing lines of where he expects Na'Vi's movements, and he's got it right on point.
Let's see what they can do. And they've got some great heroes to fight around this. Na'Vi, obviously, they do have the team fight, but you have sort of let the team fight combo break in Shashlo. You know, you can use the primal split, get him, really hold back Na'Vi whilst they go for an attempt on the outpost. The fight will begin.
Silence.
Static Storm is out, but he's already popped the primal split, so Shashlo is happy to fight. Snowball across, the swap from Ilias will use to try and get crystallized out of it. They're pots of supernova. Zayats will fall. Gambit just get themselves away from the air, but the swap back. Ilias goes for GPK, but he already had the orb out, was able to jaunt away to safety. Phase shift and a blink. GPK's out of the blood right, heal escape. Tusk will be left behind. Shashlo still trying to fight. He's going to get RP, but the backup's now in from the FNG. Drops down the poison, starts to bite away here at the Magnus. He gets ripped apart. Na'Vi have to get out of here. Ilias is going to be unable to do so as the TP is cancelled. He's beat down by the Brew as Gambit take the team fight and are able to take that outpost before the 20-minute mark. That's going to be another time a map where both outposts are in the hands of Gambit. The XP lead increases.
They got all their ultis off on Gambit pretty much perfectly, right? The Brewmaster split goes off before any of the spells go off from Na'Vi. The Puck has a Yule, so he's able to protect himself versus all those multiple different forms of silence. The Tusk Snowball as well. They took that fight very nicely versus the side of Na'Vi. And man, this Viper, even as a support, he like throws a nether toxin down and everyone's just doing a ridiculous amount of magic damage increased as well because of everything.
It adds up to some ridiculous numbers.
Yeah, he just like breaks them. This nether toxin does a lot of damage if you're standing still, and then they're just getting constantly poison attacks, so it stacks up. They get this chase forward, but
yeah, very good little escape there from GPK, getting himself all the way up towards the top.
Yeah. And there, yeah, like you said, it's an RP, but an RP for what? As he's standing in a hell of a lot of magic damage and burns down so fast. Yeah, great control coming out from Gambit there. They're keeping them now. They're at an 8k lead, and Dream is just having a freebie.
And that's the goal, you know, so XP's going to, I'd imagine, look pretty similar, the lead that we're starting to hit towards. Yeah, already at the 6k and growing very, very quickly.
And in the last 2 moments, look at these items.
Some great finds.
He got a Manta, and then he found a Vambrace and a Pupil's Gift. Look at the health on this Terrorblade. Usually you look at a health on a Terrorblade at like 14, level 14 with a Manta, and he's like 1,000 something.
Yeah, I mean, he's good to fight. He can go wherever he wants. And a BKB's only a few hundred gold away.
Yeah, he can take the attack speed talent. He doesn't even have to take the health talent now because of these items that he's gotten.
And that gets the scary part. With these items and a BKB, it's to the point where Gambit can group up as 5, walk down a lane.
Hell yeah.
And then it's sort of Na'Vi, you know, what have you got to stop us?
And it's always going to be a reflection being used onto that Vengeful Spirit to make the Terrorblade that much stronger too. So we will be seeing that come out a lot as Na'Vi's got to find a way back to fight into
They've
this.
They've got to find this team fight. They've got this combo. They have got that synergy.
But I don't know about taking a full 5 fight on right now. I think they need to get Crystallize's BKB, get a pick off, and then try to get like those five-man fights.
You get GPK, at least with the setup. He's going to be able to dodge the silence, but the Static Storm is there to follow up. GPK caught out, pushing out a little too far down bottom, as Na'Vi will punish him.
I like that move, though. That's good. Unfortunately, Crystallize doesn't get the last hit there for that big little bonus of gold, but he's almost got that BKB finish now anyway. And I think that's the double BKB that should be coming out.
Yeah,
Magical has it as well, so that could definitely help them a little bit here.
Still hitting good BKB timings. But they've got to find that combo play. It's not going to get any easier with Gambit, as we say themselves, picking up the BKB, Shashlo as well. He's already well on the way to his own as the Brew to make sure he can get the guaranteed split off every fight. We've already seen how much he's been able to do with it.
Yeah, he just, like you said, combo breaking. He just messes with the back line, and I do feel like that's one of the big reasons that they did end up picking it. And now they do. I do think we saw Vampire at least having it earlier, but he's got a blink now too. So talking about all these combos from Na'Vi, this is going to make it a lot easier for him to set up to protect his teammates.
Yeah, they've got a lot of answers on Gambit to the whole sort of flow that Na'Vi want to look for in the team fight. You know, it's very much a very, very execution-oriented lineup. You know, it's this spell after this spell. You don't want to stack them. You want to make sure that they follow on from each other perfectly.
Oh, nice little ice shards to push him out of the kinetic field there. Gets him outside as Jeebus.
They're going to dive in and try and start things off. We'll manage to pick up the toss on the back line. The supernova's down. Can Gambit get over? BKB's popped by Dream. They'll turn towards the egg. The egg is going to go off, though. Pasha, he gets the off with Magical moving in. They're taking Dream out of the fight. There's no Terrorblade. So now Na'Vi, they can start to move on for more. Shashlo's gone as well. There's been a buyback from Excess Vampire, but Gambit, without two of their cores, they cannot fight this. As Na'Vi, you saw that it's going to be another buyback. Chashlo's going to come back in. He's already used the split, though, so there's no split for this. Na'Vi will still respect it. They did blow all their ultimates. They used their combos. But that's the pattern. Certainly, with those buybacks, I mean, it was, what, like an 8K lead? It's now
completely
down to just
swung.
Two.
Yeah.
This is what you've got to watch out for. Jeez. Na'Vi, I mean, it looked like the egg should have died there, but with it being the level 2 egg and Pasha in the positioning that he was, they couldn't quite get enough hits on it. Pasha with great positioning.
Dream got slowed down a little bit. I think he got ruptured. He was running in. He started dropping a little bit low. He kind of like second-guessed himself to go for those hits, and they didn't have anybody else hitting it with him, really. It was just, I don't know. I think I saw one other person hit it once, maybe, but here we go again.
See another attempt.
On cooldown.
Crystallize. He's going to move in with the BKB.
Whoa,
with the cleave and everything. Oh, they're all just dying. Dream is going to be able to get back up to full. Turns towards Magical. Magical tries to skill away. He's not going to make it. Crystallize, he's attempting to stand his ground. A beat down on Dream. Swap back.
Swap.
Magic missile. They got the control. Dream is dead. He's going to get on the Terrorblade down for 50. Zayas will get himself back up to the high ground. Crystallize also picks out FNG. There's four dead on Gambit. It's only GPK left alive. He's trying to chase Zayas. Zayas turns, gets the Thunderstrike off the Sunray. The chase passes him with a dive. Another phase shift. Could GPK play his way out of this? The orbs out. We'll be able to join up with the burn. Pasha burns him out. Gambit get wiped by Na'Vi around the pit. As now Na'Vi could head in. Roche is incredibly low. They're going to be able to take this for themselves. And Na'Vi, they're now back on top.
What a turn of events.
That whole 8K lead, that dominant advantage around this Roshan pit has fallen apart. The decision to buy back, they felt confident knowing that Na'Vi had already used their ultimates, but they still had the BKBs. Crystallize was able to still get in there. And Pasha, I mean, his Phoenix, it's looking pretty hot. 8-1-10, destroying the team fights almost single-handedly with his positioning on the big fiery bird.
And we're seeing exactly why they changed the... They wanted to make it a priority having this hero as a position 3. Look at him just sitting in the back,
look
getting the full Sunray.
The damage numbers coming out from this Phoenix.
Yeah.
Got to be pretty insane.
Absolutely. Full Sunray. Also, beautiful spell combination with like the Shockwave pulling them into that AoE coming out too. As Dream, he gets brought down yet again, and they're not able to get their abilities off. This little clustered area is a big problem for them.
Already back in the action with a little bit of an attempt onto Pasha, but with the sun out, there's
level
no
chance.
Now it's level 3. We saw them struggle with the level 2. Good luck with the level 3.
And now he's got an Aghanim's. So, 13 hits, even more. Illusion.
And Pasha. I mean, yeah, as I say, 8-1-10, offlane Phoenix, what more can you say? And in a game as well where they were 8K behind, but it didn't matter, Pasha didn't feed. He's top net worth. He really is the king of the game right now.
Oh, he has the toggle movement ability even when he's not using Sunray right now. You usually only have that one when you use Sunray. That's a little bit weird to see him having it at the moment. It doesn't make a difference anyway, but now he can actually
press
use the Sunray. Now he can use the Sunray in the egg, and he can also pull somebody else into it too.
You can auto run, you know, like in those MMOs and JRPGs, you know, where you don't want to right click.
I don't know. I don't think I've seen the you having toggle movement when you don't have Sunray.
And I like how the tooltip just says squawk. It's like, well,
squawk!
But they spelt squawk wrong.
Squark.
Squawk?
Squark.
That's not how you spell squawk.
I guess that's the way they wanted to spell it.
S-Q-A-W-R-K, what is this? Is this an American spelling of squawk?
Well, stop, Sunray, is chirp. And now, now he lost the toggle movement. That was really weird. I don't know why he had it. I've not seen that from
him. Yeah, I'm calling hacks.
But yeah, Na'Vi getting themselves much better footing. And yeah, Pasha, top of that net worth. He's been doing an excellent job in the fights. And now Gambit, they've got to find themselves a way to take their own fights now as...
Yeah.
It's definitely problematic. They don't have solutions for this Phoenix. They don't have ways to actually hit it.
And look at that.
Ooh.
Online, that spider legs on a Bloodseeker. Imagine him zipping around the map.
With spider
over
legs.
Over terrain.
Ooh.
I mean, I...
Oh, he gave it to somebody
else.
I
gave it away.
Who did he give it to? Did he give it to the Venge? He gave it to the Disruptor. Okay.
That's just a bit of the bro move, right? You know, Disruptor, bless him. He's died 8 times.
He's going to have an ag soon. You better give him something.
Sure.
He's going to be a big deal in the fights.
You'd argue his positioning is sort of the hardest to do with sort of what he's got, right? It's very important that Zayas does get the static storm out. Now with these legs, he can play even more hidden behind terrain and know that he can still cross these previously uncrossable gaps and tree lines and get his full toolkit out.
Mm-hmm.
I like it. 28 minutes in, 20-21, 1K lead for Na'Vi. Mid lane.
He's burning.
He's burning indeed. As FNG starting to fall off a little bit. Now, this is the problem with the support Viper. And this is
this
why
is
I
problem.
Got all the reports I did when I played it. It falls off. It really does when it's as of the five. it's very easy to feed. So, you know, this is a professional as well, FNG. So you cannot blame him. It's hard. It's a hard life for the Fire Viper right now.
Trying to rationalize this for yourself?
Yes.
A little bit.
Yeah, just trying to cope.
Do have about a minute till that outpost does kick in. Na'Vi will be able to claim that bottom one for a moment. They do have four heroes right now. Vampire's still just chilling. He's like, all right, see what I can make happen down here. He wants to maybe cut a creep wave or wait for some type of retreat to happen. He does have that one ward above him a little bit north to see any rotations. But the Ags is down on Disruptor. So we mentioned already a lot about how Na'Vi's teamfight is really strong. Now it's even stronger.
Yeah, that's a great time. Yeah, you see sort of the difference in support gold. You got the other three supports of the game sitting around the 5K. Zayat's in there with the 8K.
It's that Philosopher's Stone.
Philosopher's Stone. Kicking that in. Money adds up. Not quite sure it adds up to a 3K difference with the rest of the supports, but maybe that's how broken it is. I don't know what 60 GPM is times however minutes, but 3,000 is your answer. There you go.
And they've also got a telescope too, so they have Venge with telescope. That's always really nice for pretty much everything. They got these increased cast points, or cast ranges, sorry. So they force a split.
They do.
It's Ashlo.
Ashlo is going to be able to send FNG up in the air.
They want him. They want blood.
And they're Jason. They're killing through these Broolings.
They are very squishy Broolings now.
They still want him. Is Ashlo going to be able to get out of this?
He's going to try to wave a terror as soon as it falls. Let's see. Does he get it? He doesn't, but they're going to be able to get him anyway.
No escape for Ashlo. He is trapped. Does have some greater fairy fires if he wants to burn through them, but he's going to save them for a situation where he has more of a chance of getting out of it.
And that's a pretty telltale story right there, that the fact that they chase him for 25, 30 seconds, and not a single person even decides to try to help on the side of Gambit. So Gambit is really just like, we're not fighting right now.
Well, what's the game plan for Gambit?
Let's get these farms. Let's get our items picked up. I think they're waiting for what? Like the Satanic, it looks like, on Dream?
He's close, right?
He's pretty close to it, and he's going to have the Paladin Sword on top. So, quite a lot of them left still if he does opt to have that inside of his inventory.
Morris in GPK. CD went for the bit of the right clip of the death. So, it does have the Mindbreaker, which is a very nice find. Actually, a bit of a punch on the phase shift right clicks.
Yeah, he got the death so quite early. He finished up the Ags now as well. So, it's the other one, the big pickup that he could have. Could see come into play. Do they have anything to break coil besides the goofy Ags?
I was going to say, maybe it's now time. You look at the game, there's only one way back for Gambit, and it's the Aghanim's Terrible.
Oh, God,
they got to go for the combo. I mean, it could potentially not be terrible. I will say, and maybe this game goes on. It's already 31 minutes in. It is still close.
I don't think it's one of those. Like you said, it's not one of those you buy. It's one of those you pick up.
Yeah.
Unless you do get to the point.
No, you're true. Well, we've seen Roche go down just the once this game, right? So still a couple more to go before we have any chance at that.
Who did he pass off the Vambrace to? So he gave the Viper his Vambrace.
That's nice.
And now he's going to have the Satanic on top of a Paladin Sword. So that lifesteal is going to be pretty damn high for him to sit inside of any of these spells if he is able to actually hit targets.
Does he have the damage to sort of kill these cores?
If
he's getting RP'd, supernovaed. You know,
if he's controlled, of course not.
I guess he has got that status resistance. So.
And he's got Dominator Aura, which busts him up. And he's going to be taking over. He's going to be reflectioning the Venge to be able to get that Aura. So we'll see. I think it's all about how the fight gets approached and who's got the better angle of it in this one.
We go. Coil. Down onto the two of them.
It's an Axe Coil, too.
Na'Vi are very ready to fight, though, if Gambit try and take this. Dream's going to look to step forward. Supernova's going to be popped out already with the Sunray. Beaming out across the Mortal Zeiss. Gets the Static Storm out, but Dream's in position with the BKB. Starts to punch them. It's not enough. The Supernova stun holds back the aggression of the Terrorblade for now. Gambit will still continue to try and chase. Shards are out. They'll block off the exit straight away. Crystallize, he goes for the TP away, but they've got the Yule Sever. Cancel the TP. Passage tries to get back in to save him, but the Snowball play from Vampire catches them out, and Gambit is their fight to take this time round. Four dead on Na'Vi as Gambit turn up. Na'Vi, they were hunting for a fight there. They had the whole team ready to go. They couldn't get the combo off this time. And with the BKBs, the chase, and control, great play from Vampire to shut off the escape.
Dude, GPK did a ridiculous amount of damage in that fight too. Just a couple phase shifts. He lands a dream, like such a nice dream coil in the back lines too. The egg gets forced really far away.
It was not
in the midst of the fight at all. So the stun actually only clipped like one or two of the heroes.
Yep.
And the static storm completely whiffed as far as I saw.
And now they're losing buildings. This is the power of the Terrorblade lineup. You lose a fight even without the meta. He's got good farm now to beat through.
My God.
Two sets of racks at least. They're not done. There's 30 seconds without a Bloodseeker, without a Magnus. It's going to be at least Mega Creeps. And maybe even game over.
I think it's just game over, actually, yeah. Wow, and look at, they're all tipping Zayats too. His Haddock Storm did not catch in time to be able to stop anything
he
with that Aghanim's.
He had to throw it out. It
but
was
he
falling down.
It.
He got it out, but he didn't manage to really get anything with it. The pressure was on for him.
I mean, GPK just got like such a perfect Dream Coil.
They can use
them again.
There's another Static Storm. Do they have the damage? In fact, yes, they do.
They
with the Sunray. It all adds up. They will kill off GPK. But as we say, Gambit, they get the Mega Creep advantage back on top with an 11k lead. Na'Vi now in a very tough position.
So Na'Vi spent all their gold before that fight in the mid lane. So no buybacks were available at all. And yep, you're versus a Terrorblade lineup that can easily go to push that. Look how much gold this guy has. He just finished Titanic, and he's got 5,400 on top again after that fight.
I sort of, I said as well, they're going to have the damage yet. Certainly now with Daedalus.
And it really was just so much up to these initiation. Like we're just saying, actually, Gambit got this perfect positioning for them to get that wraparound. They get the coil on two or three, and then Shashul just gets in the back lines with his primal split, and Pasha's forced to panic ult. So same thing with Zayats. They all have to kind of panic ulti, and they get punished heavily. And they pretty much just lost the game because of that. Full megas, they're gonna have to hope for some kind of big throw here by Gambit because they have a much easier game in front of them now.
Yeah, it feels definitely the big thing for Na'Vi that fight was what Pasha feeling that he had to egg very, very early and sort of a very, very reserved back and away from the fight, right? He could not get in and do the damage or anywhere close to the damage that he's been able to do in the previous fights when Na'Vi have been able to come out on top.
Na'Vi, they're trying to sneak this one here. There's no puck for 10.
They're doing it pretty quick, but Shashlo, he knows. They're heading in. The Primal Split pop. Can Na'Vi get away with it? They're trying to finish off the pit. Vampire's in. BKB pop.
The snowball.
They get it. Vampire gets the kill, and he gets the Aegis. Both of them going to Gambit. The Aegis will be popped immediately, but Na'Vi, they put their BKBs in an attempt to get it. Now GPK is in with a three-man Dream Coil. Jumps forward, he's got the feet on the high ground. Magical tries to go over the RP, but Vampire's still down the front. Pasha is dead. He's gone for 2 minutes. No buyback on the Phoenix, and they're going to continue to roll over even more. Gambit find Crystallized. They find Magical. There seems to be no hope for Na'Vi here in this fight, and with that, you would imagine it's all over, and it is. GG is called as Gambit will take this game won. A bit of a back and forth. They had a good lead at the start. We saw Gambit like an 8k advantage. And then Na'Vi with that spectacular showing around the pit were able to swing it back. But then they couldn't pull it through to the end. Gambit had that one fight back again at that tier two in the mid lane on the dire side. Na'Vi just couldn't get that team fight together.
I mean, it was really a lot up to these initiatives.